Lord, we come before you today for what will be one of the last times in this format. We look forward to worshiping you together, but Lord, help us today to not lose what we've gained and learnt. Help us to recognise your presence wherever we are. Help us to recognise your continued care and help for us today, and help us to revel in worshiping you right now. Amen.
Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the very time God had promised him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to the son Sarah bore him, and when his son Isaac was 8 days old, Abraham circumcised him as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Sarah said, "God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me." And she added, "Who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." The child grew and was weaned, and on the day Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had borne to Abraham was mocking, and she said to Abraham, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac." The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned his son, but God said to him, "Do not be distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the slave into a nation also because he is your offspring." Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down about a bow's shot away, for she thought, "I cannot watch the boy die." And as she sat there, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy when he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt.
With a melody.
Lord, we anticipate that change is going to happen over the next few weeks. Help us as we readjust to those changes. But also, Lord, keep us safe. We ask for your protection on our community as these restrictions finish, and keep each one of us safe as we enter into face-to-face relationships again. Lord, also give us wisdom on how to make adjustments as a church. Help us to find ways of reconnecting with our community, which we are called to minister to. Help us to be welcoming of all who come through our doors and to be supportive of all who are involved in our programs. We pray for the kids and the families of Playtime, Kids Church and Youth Group, as well as Bible study groups and our other gathered services on Sunday and Tuesdays. Help us too to go into homes of aged care facilities and hospitals, encouraging and supporting those who are there as they recuperate from their suffering. Lord, just help us to be your people. Amen.
Lamb of God. work on earth is done. When I stand in glory, I will see his face. There I'll serve my King forever in that holy place. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah.
Now we come to Genesis chapter 21, and this is really exciting because this is all about the birth of Isaac. God fulfills his promises to Abraham and Sarah. Listen to this. And the Lord visited Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had spoken. The Lord visited Sarah as he had said. In other words, he's saying, okay, this is happening. This is going. He's come back to visit, and he said she would be pregnant, and guess what? She's ready for birth. She's ready for it to happen. And notice it says there also, as he had spoken. The promise of the son was not fulfilled. For years and years, more than 25 years, yet all of a sudden, in the incredible space that it is, as he had spoken, it happens. Some promises of God are conditional and depend on something we must do. Other promises of God are unconditional, and God will fulfill them because he wants to. He wants to do the miracle. In verses 2 to 7, it says, for Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, who Sarah bore to him, Isaac. Then Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Now Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. And Sarah said, God has made me laugh, and all who hear will laugh with me. She also said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse a children? For I have borne him a son in his old age. This is an amazing story. Abraham called him the name that they said they were going to call him, Isaac. Originally, the name Isaac was something of a rebuke because it means kind of laughter. But it actually ended up being a joy. Isaac became a wonderful type of picture for the Messiah to come, Jesus Christ. Both were specially promised sons. Both conceptions were miraculous. Both were born after a period of delay. And both mothers were given the assurance by the truth of God. And both were also given names rich in meaning before they were born. Both also, the births occurred in God's timing. It's fabulous, isn't it? Also, both births were accompanied by great joy. Remember the Christmas story, it's coming up soon. And this is all about laughter. You see, Sarah wants it to be an amazing experience, but there's something really sad happens. Sarah wants Abraham to get rid of Hagar and Ishmael. Listen to this. So the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, scoffing. Therefore she said to Abraham, "Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, namely Isaac." And the matter was very displeasing in Abraham's sight because of his son. This is interesting, isn't it? The child grew and was weaned. And some ancients say that the child would not be weaned until 12 years of age. Some would say 5 years of age. But the most reliable resource indicates that in this case, he's probably about the age of 3 and he's quite young. Sarah saw the son of Hagar scoffing. There's conflict between the two boys, which I suppose is inevitable, even though they were approximately 13 years apart in age. Abraham found it hard to agree with Sarah's complaint when he did not want to reject his son through Hagar, Ishmael. But notice the conflict came from Ishmael to Isaac. Ishmael was scoffing at Isaac. That's pretty sad in itself, isn't it? The Apostle Paul used this conflict as an illustration of conflict between those who are born of the promise and those who are born of the flesh in Galatians chapter 4. The Jewish legalists who were troubled, the Galatians protested they were children of Abraham and thus blessed. And Paul admitted they were children of Abraham, but they were like Ishmael, not Isaac. The legalists claimed that Abraham was their father. Abraham asked who was their mother, Hagar or Sarah. You see, the Bible uses all of this history and brings it all together in such an amazing way. And the people at the time would have known exactly what Paul was talking about. But even as Ishmael and his descendants have persecuted Isaac and his descendants, we should not be surprised that modern day people who follow God, yet in reliance upon their human strength and wisdom, or in the flesh, if you want to put it that way, do in fact persecute those who follow God correctly in faith and through the promise. It goes on next when Abraham, he puts Hagar and Ishmael out of the issue, out of the scene. But God said to Abram, "Do not let it be displeasing in your sight because of the lad or because of your bondwoman. Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her voice. For in Isaac your seed shall be called, yet I will also make a nation of the son of the bondwoman, because he is your seed." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water, putting it on her shoulder. He gave it and the boy to Hagar and sent her away. Then she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. It's a bit strange, isn't it? Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her. That's harsh. Perhaps Sarah didn't want to give up Ishmael because he considered the son of Hagar was something of a backup plan. A backup heir, if you want. If something should happen to Isaac, there would always be Ishmael, probably in the back of his mind. But God didn't want Abraham to put his trust in a backup plan. He wanted the trust put in God. God wanted Abraham to trust in him. Abraham might have been tempted to reject Sarah's counsel just because it was Sarah who offered it. Instead, he sought the Lord. Now, this is significant. He sought God's opinion. And God said, listen to her. Even though it wasn't necessarily pleasing to Abraham, that's what he did. He sent her away. God's solution was clear. Get rid of the son of the flesh. That's a harsh way to put it, isn't it? There was to be no reconciliation, no peaceful coexistence with the son of the flesh. Wow. The solution is the same in our own battle between trusting God and trusting in the flesh. Cast out the bondwoman, cast out the thing that's not quite right, and trust in what God says, trust in God's grace, in the principles of our Christian life. There is no question that we belong to God, not the bondwoman. Then it says, and she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. It may have seemed ruthless of Abraham to do this, but it was exactly what God wanted, exactly what God needed to happen. You see, the flesh and blood did not make the strongest bond. God wants us to honour. There were circumstances where we can do the right thing or the wrong thing with our families. God wants us to be ruthless with the flesh in the same way. And those of us who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. But notice what happened here. He took bread and skin of water, and Abraham gave it to her. He provided something for her to start with. And off they went. Abraham realized that without God's help, no matter what he could give them, would not be enough. I wonder whether Abraham thought, he's looked after this woman and this boy before, he'll do it again. And God does preserve Ishmael and Hagar in the desert. Listen. And the water in the skin was used up, and she placed the boy under one of the shrubs. Then she went and sat down across from him at a distance of about a bow shot. For she said to herself, let me not see the death of the boy. So she sat opposite him and lifted her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the lad. Then the angel of God called to Hagar out of heaven and said to her, what ails you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad, hold him with your hand, for I will make him a great nation. Notice, the provisions that Abraham gave her weren't enough. It was to a point where, when it was used up, she was assuming they were going to die, both of them, not just the boy, but her as well. Notice too, it says, behold the compassion of a mother for her child expiring with thirst. Well, just think of that process of Hagar seeing her son in such distress. But as God does, God heard the voice of the lad. As Hagar lifted her voice and wept, God answered. Curiously, God answered in response of the voice of the boy, not necessarily Hagar's weeping. And somehow, even in infancy, Ishmael cried out for mercy and help. It says, fear not, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Despite the desperate problem in the wilderness, God's promise gave Hagar and Ishmael the reason to not be scared. God showed special favor to Ishmael because he was a descendant of Abraham. Notice it says that I will make him a great nation. And though Ishmael was not going to be the one who received the covenant promise, God was not against him. The descendants of Ishmael became a great nation, the Arabic people. They're huge. Their influence is right around the world. Promise come true. And then God opened her eyes and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink. So God was with the lad. And he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became an archer. He dwelt in the wilderness of Paran. And his mother and took a wife for him from the land of Egypt. Wow. God opened her eyes and there was a well. How did she miss that? There's a well there. How did she miss it? In her distress, in our distress, sometimes we don't see what's in front of us. God provided for Hagar and Ishmael. Yeah. In Hagar's case, the supply of their immediate needs is actually right there. The well is right next to them. It often happens that the supply of things that we need are actually quite close, whether it's provided by a friend, provided by something, or it is quite close to us. That's the way God often works. It also says, so God was with the lad. The idea is emphasized that God was not against Ishmael and his descendants. And we need to remember that. God was with Ishmael and had promised him a future. Wow. Where are we at? Are we in the desert watching someone die? Do we need to open our eyes and listen to God and see that there's our sustenance or whatever we need in front of us? Where is it? Where are we at? I ask you to pray to God and then look around for his provision. Bless you.
For the Lord God Almighty reigns.